conservators. I'm the principal groundwater manager at DEWNR, and I also sneak off for a day and a half a week to do actual research at Flinders University. So this is what I was doing while at Flinders with a cast of thousands. There were many, many separate projects which I'm going to try and summarise very rapidly, or it might not feel rapidly to you, over the next hour. Many of which I wasn't involved with. So this is going to be highly entertaining when we get to the question section. And I've got my phone handy so I can ring up the participants involved. And I haven't warned them, so it'll be extra entertaining. But I'm ready to phone a friend and answer any of the more difficult questions. So, Lower Southeast groundwater research. And there's a couple of things. Oh, that's right. That I just want to emphasise at the beginning about what makes the Southeast stand out within South Australia. And one of which is simply how much groundwater gets used down here. You can see that pretty much only Adelaide is using it with a similar kind of intensity. This is street irrigation, red for town use, and we've got mining, stuff and domestic. So really, and that's because the Southeast is blessed with comparatively fresh groundwater compared to large parts of the state. I also do a lot of work around the River Murray where it's seawater. No one is irrigating with that anytime soon. So Southeast, quite groundwater, an important part of the overall water budget. So there's some key management questions. All right, we're not going to answer all of them today, but some of the things that we're trying to address piece by piece. First one is obviously just how much water is available. How much water do we have in the groundwater system and the surface water system? That's one of the first things we need to understand before we can actually start using water in a competent fashion, I guess, or a cautious fashion. And then that's about now, but what about what happens in the future? What do we think is going to happen with the impacts of climate change? And that will be talked about considerably more tomorrow by my colleague Graham. But also changes in extraction over time as irrigation and industrial patterns change and town usage. And yes, as land use changes. And those are questions that are valid both on a regional scale across the Southeast and also more locally. And then we've also got other questions which are more about smaller areas, about resource condition triggers, buffer zones, and managing local scale processes. I'm not going to get anywhere near these. The end of our talk, I'm afraid, is about the regional stuff. There will be some small scale discussions, but the overall aim was to try and understand the system as a whole and to feed in little bits of information where we could about the different components of that. So, if I can get the magic button to not work, apparently. Oh, come on. Apparently I've already overwhelmed it with knowledge. And you know, that's only slide three. Oh, I've got some. So there's a message from Trevor Pillar popping up there. I'll have to. And the other thing to know about the Southeast, which I'm sure you're all entirely aware of, is just how complicated a system it is. And again, across South Australia, Southeast is probably one of the most complicated areas, probably the most, but don't quote me if I'm in another area. So we've got, you know, regional groundwater, we've got an unconfined system, the upper groundwater, we've got lower groundwater, we've got all this stuff happening in the system, we've got shallow water tables, which means there's a whole lot of interactions with surface water features, with wetlands, we've got drains, we've got lakes, we've got a whole lot of evapotranspiration, rainfall, and then of course all the extraction for irrigation and for towns, we've got forestry, and all of these things interact in excruciatingly complicated ways. So what we're trying to do in this one was improve, you know, to understand and manage our groundwater system. We need a good understanding of the geology, and we're also trying to get a better handle on the inputs and outputs of the system, what's flowing in and what's flowing out. Again, how much water do we have under different circumstances. So that's what we're trying to do. And there's lots of different components, possibly the geology, the layers, the properties, how fast water flows through it, how much is coming from Victoria, how much is coming from rainfall, how it interacts with all the surface water features flowing in and out of wetlands and drains, evaporation, and of course extraction and flow to coast. So trying to put this together, it has many different parts. So this led to many different projects trying to address different parts of this particular jigsaw puzzle. So aquifer structure, how much is flowing in from rainfall. I should have made that a giant jigsaw piece because that's extremely important and I will spend a good chunk of my talk talking through that. How much is going in and out of drains, wetlands, how much is going out to the coast, not just to the sea, but it also flows out under the sea for long distances before eventually going to the ocean, and you know, how much is going to wells. And the idea is to try and fit a few more of these pieces. Some pieces already exist because there's been a stack of work done previously, some of which has been done by people in this room. Try and fit a few more of those pieces together and come up with a regional groundwater model. I'll talk about that a bit later. So, a team or series of teams was assembled from CSIRO, National Centre for Groundwater Research and Training, Flinders, and DEWNR. I only have a small role. That's me a few years ago, just in case you can't tell. But really, the bulk of this work was done by these guys and a whole lot of other people whose faces were harder to Google in a short time. So a lot of this was done by Nikki Harrington. She was led a lot of this project with input from, I'll mention these names as we go past, but Russell Crosby, Leanne Morgan, Rebecca Durbel, Chris Lee, Edwin Werner, Sebastian LaMontagne, Chris Turnage, and again, a whole bunch of others, including some of the guys down here, so Jeff Lawson, Saad Mustafa. It's hard to Google Jeff Lawson, it turns out.
Very hard to catch him,
too. So I'll start with the rainfall to recharge component, and I'm going to spend a longer period of time on that because it is hugely important to how much water we're getting in groundwater. So this talk, mostly from Russell. And here and elsewhere, you'll see copies of scientific papers that have been published on these works and also the reports. And at the end, I'll just give you a summary about where you can find those, because the whole point of the Gordon Institute is that they should all be publicly available and the details and data from that available to government. So, recharge. So, how much water is getting from the surface to the groundwater system, how much additional water do we get vertically, depends on a whole stack of things. Rainfall, obviously. How much evaporation, land slopes, and how much is channeled. Soil types, vegetation, where you've got lakes or wetlands, where you've got streams, rains. So, in short, it's really difficult. But fortunately, because it's really difficult and really important, a whole lot of work has already been done in the Southeast prior to this project. But Russell and his team, Bill, Nikki, Sebastian, were able to build on. So the approach they took was essentially to look at different methods for estimating recharge. The problem with estimating recharge is that you've got to make a bunch of assumptions, and they may be more or less true at whatever site you're trying to make this observation. So here are three of the main methods, one of which has already been talked about, the use of the MODIS satellite. It's quite coarse data, but at least you've got it spatially over time. Then there are other estimates which are based on groundwater salinity, sort of the more salinities and the more evaporation has gone out, and you're trying to account for how long it has taken that water to get there. And then there's one based on water table fluctuations, which is trying to see how much the water table moves in response to rainfall. So you use all of these methods, and again, they've all got simplifying assumptions, they're all approximate, depending on where you are. And so he tried to put all of this together and see if they actually made any kind of sense. Some of the kinds of analysis that Russell did was looking at, for example, well, we've got all of this data on different sites using different methods. So that's water balance, that's the sunlight one. I'm afraid water table fluctuation ends up being W2A. And then we've got CMB, chloride mass balance, the salinity one. And then looking at what sort of, were there any correlations between vegetation type and recharge? I'm not going to go into that because I've got masses of stuff to go into, but yes, there appears to be a correlation. And also looking at things such as how recharge depends on depth to water. If you've got a very shallow water table, then maybe a lot of it's going to evaporate off, or maybe it's going to be intercepted by different kinds of crop. So I did all this kind of analysis. But the main thing, as far as I'm concerned, as a groundwater modeler, that he did for us, was he combined all of those methods to create essentially a uniform dark set. So, starting off with the satellite data is lovely because it's historical. You don't even have to have monitored, somebody else did the monitoring for you decades ago. You know, it starts in the 70s or 80s, depending on what satellite it is. For this kind of thing, it's about a kilometer scale, which is a bit coarser than I'd like. But you know, you've got regular periods of dark, regular periods of observation over a long period of time. And it covers all those spots, 1 kilometer. It's not like you had to send somebody out to collect three, you know, six samples from different locations across the southeast. It's just there. Right. But the problem with satellite data is, and forgive me, I'm not a remote sensing specialist, and I think our remote sensing specialist is back in Adelaide, so won't be able to contact me anyway. But you kind of have to tune them in that they're good for being able to compare different data sets. Anyone is a remote sensing specialist, just interrupt me and tell me that I'm glossing this a little too much. But they're good for doing comparisons, but they're quite difficult to get an exact value. So you've got to kind of tune them to other data sets. Fortunately, as we know, we actually do have a lot of data sets. There's some from Cameron Wood, Dan Walling, I'm guessing it's Glenn Walker, Richard Bennion. Quadro, he sits next to me now, you know. So, okay, I know everybody there. Done a lot of work. So you can use that to try and match this spatial stuff and get it until it's matching those actual observations more or less. So you're kind of scaling it or shifting it so that it's matching all of those hard-won field results that you have got. So that means we now have a historical recharge data set across the whole of the lower southeast. A combination of that MODIS data tuned by Russell's analysis. So we can see, or at least we've got good estimates of, nothing is perfect, good estimates of how that recharge has changed from year to year and overall trends. So that's good for us in terms of helping us get an estimate of the overall water balance across the area. What volumes and what variability do we see under what I will laughingly call natural conditions and increasingly into the future? So Russell's conclusions here, we can use the satellite-derived ET estimates to get a pretty decent recharge estimates on spatial and temporal resolution. Again, it's not perfect. There are some places where it would probably be do with a bit of tweaking. There are some areas where it's a better match than others. But he did correct a particular bias in that satellite data by comparing it with all the field results. I think this is actually the most important thing, is that you do actually need to combine a whole bunch of different methods in order to get a data set that you can mostly trust to get that full story on recharge. But it means we have those estimates now. That's good, we have a historical data set. Next, what about the future? As we move forward 1 second per second into it, we want to be able to estimate, you know, we've got that historical information, but what do we think is going to happen in the future in terms of climate change, or as conditions change, land use, irrigation, what have you. And that's even harder. This is led by Rebecca Doble. I'll get into it, but there are actually kind of two teams running here. One at CSIRO, that's led by Beck, and one with Leanne and John Hudson at Flinders. So I've got my historical data set, but how do we go forward? So in the past, we just guessed, actually. Or we assumed that it was some particular percentage of rainfall. That's a common method. Or we just assume some sort of long-term assessment and we just plumped it by, you know, loosely by which weather zone you were in, essentially, which climate zone you were in. And that's what most of the groundwater models that have existed today do. And we were trying to make really quite a substantial leap forward in order to come up with something that changed over time, that was based on physics, and would match well with that historical data set that we now have. So, other than making, you know, an informed guess, past method, most of these involve unsaturated zone modeling. Unsaturated zone modeling is notorious, even amongst modelers, for requiring vast amounts of information that you don't have in order to simulate things. I'm getting a bit of a glare from Graham because I'm all of this work in his PhD. So there were three approaches that were considered as part of this GOIDA work. One of which, waves. Waves is, has everything in it. You give it all the parameters that you've got. It runs on a daily time step. It takes everything into account. It takes forever to simulate. And it only does it for, all these only do it for like one spot at a time. So you're trying to do the whole lower southeast, doing tens of thousands of spots with a long run time is not good for a regional model. So we kind of said, not doing waves. Then we looked at Leachin, which was developed by John Hudson at Flinders Uni. Essentially, it was originally developed as an irrigation model. It's a lot faster, but it does have some limitations. It doesn't generally allow your water table to change. And how much recharge you get does depend on where the water table is. So it's a good second or third approximation for recharge. And that's what we ended up using. Meantime, the CSIRO crew were trying to go one further step. And they were using waves to run a sample set of possibilities, like build up a table of what, you know, you have to, I'm getting ahead of myself. Using waves in a summary form, so I'll get to that. And that would be one step. That would be better, but lack some of the limitations of this one. So the Leachin one, the one that was done by Flinders, unsaturated zone model, this is the one we did end up using in our regional model. And we're also now using this technique not just for lower southeast, but my group at DEWNR are now expanding this for the upper southeast as well. So we quite like this as a methodology. So using this code, essentially what you tell it, you give it a soil map, you give it a land use map, you give it some weather, and then it sort of plots out that there are all these hundreds of different kinds of zones that are a combination of those. And then it will calculate what the recharge is. And as land use can change over time, and the weather changes over time, so you get different results. I have an animation. It's not very exciting animation. But I know it is after lunch, so. So this is the sort of thing that you get out of Leachin, and you'll see some of the limitations straight away. So this is how much recharge do you get over time? The darker the blue, the more recharge the groundwater system, so there's always water coming from the lake, coastal lakes. And then the rest of it will depend largely on what's happening in terms of rainfall, but also as land use changes. You'll immediately see that it's got that tiled effect, and that's because of the climate zones. Because we don't have anything to really interpolate inside that at the moment. So, not perfect, but considerably better than just saying, well, it's a certain percentage of the rainfall. It's taking in a lot more of the information. that's what we're using, that's what we use, and also what we're now expanding out using that methodology. My colleagues have been sitting down with John Hudson to get them to rewrite the code, in fact, to make it do something they didn't before to help out. This is the approach that Rebecca Goebel was heading up. Kind of similar in that it does take the climate, vegetation and soils information, creates that landscape key, that very detailed map of different types. And then it would run through, for each of those types, it would run through essentially a sample simulation of the unsaturated zone and create what amounted to a lookup table. So for a particular water depth and a particular soil type and a particular vegetation type, what would you get? And the plan was that software would be written so that our usual computer code, modflow, would just read the lookup table every time step and say, ah, the recharge is clearly this. So that would be a lot faster than running all of those waves models for each time step in each location. We can take advantage of the lookup table as a good approximation. And then we would be able, we'd have an absolutely superb method of estimating recharge in future. However, that project started a little later than I think all of us would have liked. So it didn't actually manage to get that far. And there were still at the stage of ironing out bugs, essentially. Still doesn't produce quite that good map. So this would be the best method, but it needs more work. So that one, that was a sort of stretch goal, and didn't quite get there for that one.
Is it going to continue?
We would love to, but that's like, I think it is talking to a couple of people, but not quite sure what that has progressed to. Certainly it'd be good if it did. And the other thing is that was using all of this stuff. So far, I've been using the MODIS satellite, which is that coarse resolution. The data sets were a 1 kilometer scale. Really love to move to a finer scale from Landsat, which is now available from Geoscience Australia. That's on my list of things to do if I find time and money. And also, we need to better understand how gutter transpiration works as well. We'll get to that too. So there's still lots to do there, but I think it's worth doing because recharge is such a huge component and it's a very variable component of the water budget. But that's as far as we got. Not just for southeastern Sydney, it's going to be hugely interesting elsewhere. Okay, and then, so that's that part of the jigsaw puzzle. Now we'll talk about outflow to the coast. And this was work led by Sébastien Lamontagne, notorious ice fisher at the CSIRO, his team, Chris, Andrew, and Stan. Again, there's a paper. Now, this is about how much, so this is how much outflow we're getting. Talked about some of the inflows, now how much is going out, I'll call naturally to the sea, or naturally under the sea. So some of it will actually discharge to the sea, and some of it goes way far out under the continental shelf before it reaches the, actually flows out anywhere. So how do we estimate this? Now, Sébastien was keen to trial a method that has worked very successfully in St. Vincent's Gulf. You take a boat out, again, I'm not expert in this, take a boat out, you get samples, and you look at the isotopes and the chemical composition, and you compare that of the different kinds of samples you already have from the groundwater, as well as the sea. And from this, you should be able to kind of gradient, see how the chemistry is changing, and from that work out, be able to start working out how much of that volume, that sea volume, is actually coming from the groundwater. Unfortunately, it turns out that the ocean off the coast here is not really very much like St. Vincent's Gulf. So, you know, it would have been fantastic if the method had worked, but it turns out that it is just, and you know, that's what we were all hoping for, but it turns out that, yeah, the seas, they just mix the waters too much. They had a lot of a lot of difficulty interpreting the results that they got. They did eventually get a sort of estimate, but it seems to be wildly out from other estimates, so we don't know which is correct. So I think this is the needs more work statement from Sebastian. That was a bit sad, but you try these things and you hope they work, because if they do, it's great, and if they don't, well, that's, if you knew it was going to work beforehand, it wouldn't be research, right?
So. Is that 1,000 gigalitres going out?
Yes, yeah.
So that's the size of the wop.
Yeah. So that's why we would really like to get a better science derived estimate of what these volumes are. It's quite an important piece. There are other ways that you can deal with that. My colleague Leanne was starting to do that, although unfortunately she's now got a job in New Zealand, so she's working on something completely different. She was starting to look at cross-sectional models and a little bits of information that we have off the coast. There are a few observations off the coast from rigs. She's now working on other things. So there's other stuff we could do there. All right, now wetlands. In and out, not just inflows, can be outflows, can be both. Again, this was led by Sebastian. I cut and paste more. Yes, so some of the questions there, and obviously there's a lot more detailed discussion of wetlands this morning. But partly what we want to know is how much of the water that's going into wetlands is from groundwater, how much from surface water, and where the sources are. And can we do that on a regional scale? But they started off small by looking at three particular wetlands. Bull Lagoon, Deadman Swamp, and Lake Road, I think. Of course, Deadman Swamp decided not to cooperate and dried out completely, so there wasn't really a lot of data that they could actually get from that site. But they were taking a whole lot of chemical samples in order to try and understand what's going on. And broadly speaking, the idea is that we've got some wetlands which are mostly being recharged, so a lot of rainfall or creek flow into those. Some where the water is flowing on one side is flowing out of the other, those are groundwater. And others, the coastal ones mainly, which is where groundwater is being evaporated out, so they're discharge wetlands. And we've got this gradient as we go through. And that it also matters in terms of management where the groundwater is coming from. Is it mostly from a local system? So you're trying to manage a wetland. Is it the local surrounding area that you're trying to look after? Or is it that they're coming from further away or even deep regional systems? It's on one scale. So it's a good way of summarizing what you know, checking it, and finding out what it is that you don't know. But if you get it to a situation where it seems to be matching the historical records sufficiently, then you can, with caution, use that to say, well, what if something changes? What happens in the future? You can use it in a predictive sense. Or you can use it to explore a range of possibilities. Maybe there's one thing you don't know very well, or maybe it's here, or maybe it's here. Run both cases through your model and find out what that impact is. But they're not magic. I'd really like it if they were, but they're not. So we had a few other things to finally put all of these pieces together, insofar as we know them, put them all together in our regional groundwater model. Some of these pieces are still missing, obviously. And we grabbed a few more as we went past in order to help construct the model. So Steve Barnett, along with some of the guys down here, completely reviewed the hydrostratigraphy, so the geology and where the water is flowing underground, remap that in detail, so that's now also available. And we also did a lot of work to try and estimate past extraction, because that hasn't always been monitored. We started out by looking at historical land use maps in order to estimate how much water those different crop types would actually need and therefore would be extracted depending on the rainfall. I probably shouldn't say there's a lot more work going on with that at the moment. And then try to use that information against also our records of where the pumping wells are, where they were built, where we've got that information, and how much they are extracting now that they are properly monitored. And so use that to come up with a data set of extraction over time. So again, this is all available, all published, or ready to use. That's our best guess at the moment for how extraction has changed over time across the whole of the lower southeast, both the unconfined aquifer and the deeper confined aquifer. Okay, and then there was some studies about drains. This is where we got to with the drains. We needed to include them in our model. They're obviously a huge important part of the hydrogeology of the southeast. We went through all the as much of the historical records and talked to anyone we thought might know about when the drains were built, location, elevation, width. Sometimes bring somebody up and saying, can you just go out and check and see how deep it is over there? It's about 2 meters for it. We would put that in. So again, we've got this as a fairly simple data set, summarizing what we know. However, we were kind of limited in that very little of this has been monitored. So it's quite hard for us to work out how much water is going into the drains from the groundwater in some places, and how much is going out to the drains from groundwater in others, and how that changes under different circumstances. You know, we can simulate that, but without enough data to compare to, as a check, then you know we don't know if our guess is right. So we did what we could, but there is limited drainage data. If I'm wrong there, please let me know. We'd be very interested.
So some of those drains there, I mean, you say sort of 1970.
Yes.
I mean, some of those are established in 1863.
This is prior to.
Yes,
so,
I know, but I mean, that's prior to is 1863, like 100 years before that date.
Yeah. So the reason I've got 1970 here is because our main simulation runs from 1970. But where possible, we have included that particular data, because, it's one of the earliest changing features in South Australia.
In the bottom corner in Big Swamp, did you leave those out there?
I think we've left out some.
Hey, Bob Creek's not there. Yeah. All of that area, there's massive water there.
Yeah. So we put in the ones I think that we thought were acting as drains. I can't remember, I'd have to check. I know that there was an explicit reason why we missed out some of the ones down here. I just can't remember what it was, it was 3 years ago. So I can check.
Very likely this is going to be construction data of those drains and then taken off right here as never did have any elevation.
And there's a hell of a lot of farmers' drains on a lot of that land too that that actually won't show the not drainage board or anything like that. They connect into the drains and they drain significant areas.
So I'm checking to see why we've got that because I've got to be licensed.
Dream on.
Why did you go so far into the division?
Oh, I should have said that. Oh, maybe I'll get to that in two slides, I think.
Oh,
yes. So, having assembled as much as we could, although it sounds like we might be able to pick up some more drain information, we then set about setting up the groundwater flow model. It's the first time we've got a fully regional model of the lower southeast that simulates both the confined aquifer, the lower aquifer, and the upper unconfined aquifer. And that's that point there. Why does it extend so wide into Victoria? And that's because we're trying to simulate the whole groundwater system sensibly. And essentially, this is where most of the sediments are. So the model, the extent, the hydrogeology doesn't care about the border, right? So But so the model boundaries have been picked according to the natural boundaries of the groundwater system. So for example, through here, this is the Dundas Plateau. So that's in Victoria. So that does feed water into the system, but that's mostly a hard rock system, whereas this is the sedimentary aquifer. So we extend that into Victoria so that we have a natural boundary. And similarly up here, this is running, so we've got an overflow boundary there because of the angle of the groundwater flow from the Murray Darling Basin system, which is obviously, this is a small corner of down here. And this is the coast. We did actually spend a lot of time arguing about whether we should in fact extend the model under the coast, because that's what it actually does. But in the end, we decided that we didn't have enough data at this point in time to actually do that. So it's based on, the extent is based on the hydrogeology. That meant that so I should have mentioned that earlier, actually. It means that, for example, wherever possible, these data sets do extend across the border. We talked to Victoria, we got information from them, so that we could map that properly. So you know, there's the border there, so I should probably mention it. And that's also a bit of a cross-check, essentially, to make sure that our data sets in South Australia are matching those in Victoria. So they cross over. It's not always true, but for example, the well data, we didn't really get very much on it. Victoria, so that's not in there. But where possible, we did try and use the interstate data. Yes?
Would it be really important if 8 Mile Creek had significant water that was going out to sea that you haven't calculated? Would that change? I mean, wouldn't 8 Mile Creek in gigalitres have more than most of the other drains put together?
Yep.
Well, it's a lot.
Yeah, for the year.
Yeah, for the year. But wouldn't it be important? Is it not important for the, you know, when you've got a model that's looking pretty good, that you've got it pretty much set up? I'm not being critical, just asking the question.
Yep.
If one big block of it is missing, wouldn't it be essential for you to get that in too?
So there's two parts of my answer. First of all, is we assess the model against historical information for the water table. So if we are correctly simulating the water table, which is influenced by the creek, right, we're not trying to assess how much water is flowing out from the creek, we're just trying to see how much is going directly from the groundwater into it. So if we are correctly mimicking the water table at that location, then we should be pretty much right. But the other part of that is that the whole model, because it's that regional scale, is just kind of coarse. So it's designed really only to answer coarse regional questions. The way that Nikki wanted this project to be set up was so that we would be answering, getting the overall picture regionally, but we're well aware that this model does not contain all of the local data, and that the next step then is to start including that local scale data so that we are able to deal with important local components, essentially, and make sure that we get that right. We're focusing purely on the big picture, but that's definitely the next step, is to incorporate that level of data and to check it all. Because again, we're checking it against the large-scale data sets that we had, but as soon as you look locally, you're going to have a whole lot more information at that scale, and a lot more local knowledge to be incorporated. So that's what we're wanting to do next for this. Yeah. So the objectives overall of this model, to summarise and update the available data, it's forcing us to summarise all of that information and produce these particular data sets, assess the broad scale, the regional water balance, identify data and conceptual gaps, I've tried to go through those as we've been talking, and then this is the provide the framework for small scale models. If we get the big picture sort of right, then we can start looking more locally, add in that more level of detail, check that it's still consistent with the regional patterns, and in turn, as we improve our understanding of a smaller area, we can improve our regional scale model. Yeah, it's always a limitation. So it also includes all of the old knowledge, not just the stuff that came out of this study, of course, so lots of aquifer transmissivity, lots of potential retrograde head information, all that kind of stuff. And for those who have an interest in any of those sort of things, the groundwater business model, running model of 2005. It's quite large, it spans 42,000 square kilometres, three layers, unconfined aquifer, aquitard, confined aquifer. And in some cases, as you may well know, three layers is, that's not going to be enough for local scale things because of the local hydrology. 1 kilometre by 1 kilometre grid size, so that's what I mean by regional scale. And we ran it from 1970 to 2013. With monthly stress periods, we could get some of those seasonal impacts, given that some large parts of the southeast respond very strongly seasonally. So I'm going to wrap up with just a couple more slides. So for example, this is looking at how depth to water table has changed over the past 40 years, at least with the model results. And we can play with that and see what the impact is of different features. And where possible, check it against data. And this is a different kind of experiment we did. Because those are cells are 1 kilometre by 1 kilometre, and you're trying to estimate how much is evaporating off. And a lot of the amount of evaporation you get is going to depend on the depth to water. The depth to water is going to depend hugely on the topography, right? So we did some experiments about how we estimated the topography. You know, 1 kilometre by 1 kilometre, how do you pick that single elevation for something that scale? You know, it's huge. So we did a bunch of experiments. You know, we picked the median, or we picked the top value. We picked the bottom value that allowed the evaporation to go X metres below the surface. And what we found was that depending on that exact assumption, all of which could sound perfectly valid, we got quite different model results. So we trialled different things until we got a reasonable match to observations. But that's currently one of the weak points in the model, is that we don't really, particularly on this scale, that's one of the downsides of using a model on this scale, is that it's hard to do with evapotranspiration. We probably have better results looking at that on a smaller scale and with follow-up studies. So at the moment, it includes all the major regional data sets. It's been tested against historical information. We've got a preliminary regional water balance. Now, we started some uncertainty analysis, but that it could do more on that. And it's probably useful for, well, should be useful for regional scale questions, but very important, local scale information not included yet. And for answering local scale questions, you need to take it and add all that local scale information. Because you can't make that stuff up, you've got to use the real thing and then improve the model locally for that. There's two reports on those. And essentially, this section of the groundwater studies are. So, all of these are reports which are available at the DEWNR website, as Michelle was talking about. There's also a few research papers that were published as well in the literature. And also, if you want those data sets or those models and you're with government, you can request them. The whole DEWNR agreement was that all of those materials created by these studies should be available for DEWNR in perpetuity. So we've got this thing, the Science Model Warehouse. This is for model specific stuff. You can look up different regions and it will show you where we've got different models of various sorts. Surface water, groundwater, border institute ones. Yes. Yeah, so you can look up where these are and then you can request that information. Essentially, and indeed the whole model, so if you've got a particular thing you want to be working on. Just fill out a very short form which essentially says who you're with and what you want to use it for. I'll come across my desk. And again, and if it's a government thing, then it will get released. We haven't had any non-government ones, so I'm not sure what happens then.
It's always everyone public access.
And also this information and the data sets are also listed under the Australian National Database System Survey Service. But again, it's hard to know that you won't go looking there unless you know that something already exists quite a lot of the time. So I've tried to highlight a lot of the data sets that we produce in this because they're potentially of use. And again, if there's gaps, then we need to know about it so that we can fix them up and improve them. What will happen over time is that over at DEWNR, as problems arise, as we're working on areas, we will be adding further information and advancing this as we go. So, you know, this is a particular stage. We'll keep going as time and money allows to keep improving things. We've got some of those things ticked off, other things could do more work. So just to summarise, because I know it's been quite a lot of, we've now got detailed aquifer layering, we've got estimates of historical recharge, but we need more work to try and estimate that sensibly, both recharge and evapotranspiration, those are hard. Not just here, I'm also working on projects well outside of the southeast, and those are still hard outside of here. Detailed estimates of well extraction, some initial mapping of land use change over time. I'm hoping another project will give us better results soon. We had that trial of estimating flow to the coast, and now it didn't work as well as we hoped. But you know, that means we need to find another method. Maybe it's modeling, maybe it's something else. We've got a wetland conceptual model about the interaction between surface and groundwater, but we need good monitoring before we can use that model. Drain networks mapped over time, possibly some emissions, so that, but we don't have any much drain monitoring to actually test anything against. We've got our regional groundwater model, which is sort of ready now to add that local information to answer those local scale questions in a regional water. So, and thanks to the DEWNR Institute for Water Research for funding that, and for the large number of people who contributed to quite a variety of projects.
Thank you.